This video is sponsored by Hoya Miles. Around the world, nations are phasing out coal power plants in favor of solar and wind. Yes, to reduce CO2 emissions, but also because they're cheaper. But there is a catch. Wind and solar aren't constant, so you need energy storage as well. And while carbon dioxide has been vilified for decades, what if it's actually not the villain in this story, but the hero, with properties that make it good for storing energy? Well, 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 how the turntables. Yes, a carbon dioxide battery. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. Carbon dioxide, or CO2, is frequently considered the main culprit behind global warming, despite not being a particularly strong greenhouse gas. Yet we need greenhouse gases in our atmosphere because they help keep the Earth's surface warmer than the freezing emptiness of the surrounding space. The problem is the scale at which we're pumping CO2 in the atmosphere by burning vast amounts of fossil fuels, which is upsetting the delicate balance between too hot and too cold. This is the main driving force behind the research and development of clean and carbon-free renewable energy sources like wind and solar. However, the fact that these technologies are becoming more cost-effective than fossil fuels is really what's driving most of their demand. This is similar to how sleek design, performance, and low cost, and not the fight against climate change, is why Teslas and other EVs are so desirable. But as I mentioned at the start of the video, these technologies have a major hurdle to overcome. Intermittency. They're not always able to produce power when the grid demands it. The key to overcoming this problem is energy storage. We simply produce all the renewable energy we can whenever we can and store the surplus production for when the wind and solar power isn't enough to meet the demand. Now that I've moved into my new home, I get to go on my solar journey all over again, and that's where a sponsor this week, Hoya Miles, comes in. Hoya Miles is one of the fastest growing solar microinverter companies globally, and their microinverters take the DC power from your solar panels and inverts it to AC for your home. Hoya Miles combines the amazing engineering of super efficient and long-lasting 25-year warranted microinverters in America with amazing prices. They make the common one-in-one inverter, meaning every solar panel gets its own inverter, but the really amazing part is their two-in-one and four-in-one microinverters, which work on two or four solar panels respectively, saving you up to 50% on microinverter costs compared to the competition, and it's even cheaper than a solar edge string inverter. Unlike string inverters that work on all your solar panels and last around 10 years, microinverters only invert the power from 1 to 4 panels, meaning less work, heat, and way longer life of 25 plus years. Also, shading on one panel only affects that panel, compared to string inverters in series where shade on one panel drops the output of the entire string of panels. Hoya Miles also includes free lifetime energy monitoring, meaning you can check on your panels and inverters in real time to see how your system is performing. Whether you're considering going solar or a solar installer, check out the links in the description to see why I've decided to go with Hoya Miles for my system. Huge thanks to Hoya Miles and you for supporting the show. It will be thanks to energy storage coupled with renewables that you can enjoy stable and reliable electricity at lower cost than traditional fossil fuel power utility grids. But many of the current energy storage technologies are either too expensive, require massive amounts of space, or require energy-intensive mining of rare earth materials like nickel and cobalt, which are in limited supply. So what we need most right now is a cost-effective, long-lasting energy storage solution we can build easily and quickly anywhere in the world, and that is made out of abundant, cheap, and easy-to-produce materials already in large supply. Is that really so much to ask for? Well, according to the Italian startup Energy Dome, it's not. Their solution? Build the world's first carbon dioxide battery. Now, I know what you're probably thinking. If I had a dime for every startup that claimed their breakthrough tech would change the game for this or that, only to watch a YouTube video 2 years later explaining why it didn't. But Energy Dome is different. In less than 3 years, the Milan-based startup founded by Claudio Spadaccini in 2019 has already built an operating commercial pilot-scale prototype in Sardinia, Italy. Now, it has secured funds to build a full-sized utility-scale version for the European utility A2A. That was amazingly fast, and it's a testament to how effective their technology is. But how does the CO2 battery work? In essence, the CO2 battery works very similarly to liquid air energy storage, only uses carbon dioxide instead of air. When charging, the system takes carbon dioxide gas from a huge bladder-like atmospheric gas holder or dome and uses electricity to compress, condense, and store the resulting liquid carbon dioxide in steel vessels at ambient temperatures and pressures around 60 to 70 bar. When discharging, the liquid CO2 is evaporated and the gas powers a turbine generating electricity. The turbine's exhaust fills the dome with gaseous CO2 at ambient temperatures and pressures, returning the battery to its initial state. At its core, storing energy is about finding the natural equilibrium of nature. push electricity into a chemical battery, and a chemical reaction occurs that builds up chemical potential energy that can be used later. With air, picture a balloon. As you fill it up, the pressure inside the balloon is much higher than in the room, and if you let it go, the balloon will try to reach equilibrium, releasing that energy and go flying across the room. But what makes this battery different? And most importantly, why should you care? There are several key advantages to CO2 batteries. The first is the working fluid itself, CO2. Contrary to air, carbon dioxide is one of the few gases we can compress into a liquid at ambient temperatures. This eliminates the need for cryogenic storage that requires temperatures below 238 degrees Fahrenheit, around 150 degrees Celsius. A second advantage is that the system incorporates a thermal energy storage system to capture the heat released when the carbon dioxide condenses and uses that same energy to evaporate the liquid carbon dioxide when the battery is discharging. This makes the battery more efficient than a liquid compressed air battery, which requires external heating to boil and liquefy the air. Furthermore, and perhaps most importantly, the basic components of the CO2 battery are steel, carbon dioxide, and water, plus standard off-the-shelf equipment like pumps, compressors, and generator turbines. Since we can find steel, water, and CO2 anywhere in the world, and equipment can be shipped almost anywhere, there's no place where this couldn't, in principle, work. Additionally, these sources are in large supply in the Earth's surface. This means that this technology avoids the supply chain hurdles that lithium-ion batteries and other technologies will almost certainly face in the future. So, now we know how the system stores energy, but how much energy can it store, and how does it compare to other technologies in terms of performance? While the pilot plant has a capacity of 4 megawatt hours and is rated for a power of 2.5 megawatts, this is enough to power close to 4,400 average Italian homes for a little over an hour and a half. Not much. But remember, this is a pilot plant. Their larger utility scale facility, which is expected to go online at the end of 2023, is a 200 megawatt hour battery that can deliver up to 20 megawatts of power. That will be enough to power 35,000 average Italian homes for 10 hours straight, or 350,000 homes for about an hour. The good news is that if we need more power or storage, these systems are relatively easy to scale up by simply adding more liquid CO2 storage vessels, more generator turbines, and making the dome bigger. According to Energy Dome, the system can store between 6 and 11 times more energy than any other compressed air storage device currently available, and with a dramatically higher round-trip efficiency of between 75 and 80%, dwarfing compressed air's 45 to 70% efficiency. These efficiency ratings compare pretty closely to pumped hydro storage systems, which can achieve around 80% efficiency. Pumped hydro currently makes up around the same percentage of Italy's grid as wind, solar, and other renewables combined. But where the CO2 battery truly shines is in cost. Since this battery uses no special equipment and no exotic materials like lithium or cobalt, the cost can be brought far below the competition, including lithium-ion batteries. According to the Energy Dome CEO Claudio Spadaccini, the levelized cost of storage, or LCOS, for a full-scale 25-megawatt, 200-megawatt-hour plant will be in the range around $50 to $60 per megawatt-hour of stored energy. For comparison, the LCOS for a 4-hour, 100-megawatt, 400-megawatt-hour lithium-ion battery system is between $131 and $232 per megawatt-hour, while compressed air storage systems can cost a whopping $300 per megawatt-hour or more. Even pumped hydro systems, which can last up to 150 years, have LCOS prices around $186 per megawatt hour, nearly four times the cost of the CO2 battery. You could think that this doesn't have anything to do with you or I, but remember, renewable energy needs renewable energy storage, so the cost of that storage is unavoidably tied to the levelized cost of energy, which ultimately determines how much you will end up paying for electricity. Reducing the cost of storage by a factor of 2 or 3 could have a significant impact, making solar and wind even cheaper than they are now, helping phase out fossil fuels even faster. But of course, as everything in engineering, there's always a trade-off. Even though the system is about as efficient as pumped hydro, an efficiency of 75 to 80% implies that we lose about 20 to 25% of that energy in the battery. Compared to lithium-ion batteries, which boast some of the highest round-trip efficiency ratings at around 90%, that means CO2 batteries waste over twice as much energy as lithium-ion battery counterparts do. Another important performance metric is energy density, which measures the amount of charge per unit volume. This gives us an idea of how small we can make a battery. According to Energy Dome, liquid carbon dioxide at 70 bars has an energy density of around 66 watt-hours per liter. But that's just the CO2. The real energy density for the entire system is much lower because we have to factor in the volume of all the necessary hardware, water, tanks, turbines, and let's not forget the huge dome to house the CO2 gas when the battery is discharged. all of which drops the energy density down even further. Let's do a quick calculation. As I mentioned a minute ago, the biggest commissioned storage plant is set to store 200 megawatt hours, and the closed system is set to pack a couple of hundred metric tons of CO2. So let's assume 200,000 kilograms. When the battery is discharged, all that CO2 is stored as gas in the dome at ambient temperature and pressure. With this information, plus CO2's molecular weight, which is 44, a pressure of 1 atmosphere, and a temperature of 298 degrees Kelvin, which is pretty much standard ambient conditions, we can use the universal gas law to calculate the volume that CO2 will occupy, and therefore the volume of the dome. Compared to the dome, the size of the other parts of the system are negligible, so we'll use that volume to estimate the energy density of the system. This is almost at the high end of pumped hydro, which is one of the least energy-dense storage systems we know of. But if we compare this to a lithium-ion cell, the CO2 battery has a density almost 200 times lower. So we won't be seeing Teslas driving around with huge domes on the rooftops anytime soon. Although that could be really steampunk meets cyberpunk. But I digress. Either way, while not an option for mobile applications, Energy Dome CO2 battery has other things going for it that make it an ideal candidate for stationary storage, where size and weight doesn't matter all that much. For example, CO2 batteries last at least twice as long as lithium-ion batteries, around 30 years, without any degradation or loss in capacity. This is one of the factors that makes this energy so cheap, and it's why I think we'll see these massive white pockets of carbon dioxide lining our future solar and wind farms in places where hydro isn't an option. It's no wonder that Energy Dome already struck a deal with Ørsted, the first energy company to transition to renewables from fossil fuels and the world's leader in offshore wind power, to build a series of 20 megawatt, 200 megawatt hour storage facilities in some of their wind farms. Again, remember that this is happening only 3 years after the company's inception. In terms of safety and environmental impacts, there is very little risk of CO2 leaking into the atmosphere since it's in a closed system similar to freon gas in our car's AC system. But even if it did, the amount of CO2 would be a drop in the bucket compared to the 6,000 million metric tons of CO2 already in the atmosphere, or the amount coming from burning fossil fuels. The CO2 battery won't take carbon dioxide directly from the atmosphere and store it. Instead, we'll need to charge it at the beginning of its operation. From an economics point of view, this would create a market demand for industrial carbon dioxide, boosting the development and deployment of carbon capture devices like my good friend Matt Farrell from Undecided, as I've covered in previous videos. But sadly, just like with recycling, the question that hasn't been answered is, will it just be cheaper to make new CO2 than to actually carbon capture it from the atmosphere? This is the problem with recycling, and I think we have to wait and see. Ideally, all the CO2 for CO2 batteries should come from carbon capture in the atmosphere, because then it's not just energy storage, but it's also reducing the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. Win-win. But something tells me we're gonna have to force companies to do that, because it might not be as cheap as buying new CO2. But what I find even more exciting is how simple this technology really is. And with big utilities like the ones in Ørsted and A2A jumping on board the CO2 battery bandwagon, I don't think it'll be long before other companies catch on and start developing newer and even better CO2 batteries to compete with Energy Dome. In my opinion, the fact that this technology actually already exists today in the real world, and it's being rolled out at a commercial utility scale in only 1 year's time, is what makes this such a promising and potential candidate for energy storage long term. So compared to compressed air or cryogenic batteries, which we've covered before, this has a huge advantage because it doesn't have to be frozen down to near absolute zero. This can work at room temperatures. That's the magical component of CO2 that makes this battery possible, and that's what leads to a much better round-trip efficiency. Plus, it's really easy to scale. We can make these by the dozens at every wind and solar farm to help with some of the problems that intermittency poses. But what do you guys think? Do you think Energy Dome and other companies can really bring this to commercial viability and build this at a scale that would be needed for energy storage problems in the future? I'd love to know. And if you're curious about why we need CO2 and we can't just use air, right? It's everywhere. It doesn't have to be filtered or anything else. Check out this battery video that we made on cryogenic energy storage next. I'm Ricky. Thanks so much for watching. We'll catch you guys next week.